I'm glad you're here to join me. I know it's the tail end of the conference. I know that sitting there for 10 minutes watching me try to find my mouse and then pulling you in is a great way to have a very interactive live experience. I encourage you all to try it next time you are giving a talk. For anyone who wants to follow along, I do have all my links are in my slides. I have a bit.ly link. My GitHub repositories are connected, and if you have any questions, because I will now be going all the way up to my max time, find me on Slack and we can talk after. So yes, my name's Lorena Mesa. I hail from Chicago. I'm a true, proud Chicagoan. there's some Chicago folks here. And as you can probably gather from some of those photos I collected, I am always like very big and smiley and like really, really excited about things, be it it's running 26.2 miles or cosplaying a Star Trek or learning to play the accordion or just, you know, doing Taekwondo. These are things I like to do in my free time. I do actually work at GitHub during my day job, and I do a lot in the Python open source community. Specifically, I am the vice chair for the Python Software Foundation Board of Directors. Glorified email reader. But really, I imagine the reason you're here is you heard something about telenovelas, right? Yes! So I personally love telenovelas quite a bit, and you're going to hear a little bit of about strange things I do in my free time. But this talk really was, for me, the idea of it came about because I myself am not a machine learning engineer. I do work as a data engineer, but in wanting to explore and understand more about deep learning, I figured why not combine two things, Python, telenovelas, and just like throwing something wacky at the wall and see what happens. So that's gonna be a little bit of today's talk. So let's go ahead and get right into it. So where have we seen deep learning in the world around us? Perhaps you've seen it in places like this, and if you can help me with my mouse and you can see it, because that's a video, that would be dope. Do you see it? Okay, let's see if I can push. Oh, nope, that didn't work. not again, and back to mouse. Nothing? Okay. Yes, this is going to be interactive. And it's okay if this one doesn't load. I know the Wi-Fi here is a little wobbly. But one place where we can see deep learning in the world around us is what is explained here is called a deep glint, which uses deep learning to derive insights on the behaviors of objects like people and cars. And in the different sequences that you see, in the first clip, you see a series of folks milling around. Actually, the second clip is the one that's more interesting, showing folks milling around in a bank. And in that bank, there's kind of circles around them showing their rotation and how their body, like tracking individual objects, kind of understanding the orientation of those individuals, and also just giving us a lot of visual information about what's happening real time with the objects that it's able to track and identify. Around 50 seconds in this clip, we're able to actually see in real time analysis of traffic capturing motorists both in cars and on motorcycles. So what's kind of interesting is they put side by side in the highway view, you're registering cars, and then on the other side you see that they're actually registering folks on motorcycles, and they're actually taking images of their faces and registering not only the license plates of the vehicles, but also the individuals that are driving on these cars. So while that video is kind of playing, no, not really. I'm just gonna keep moving because we're tight on time. That is something you can go back and click in and check out in my slides. Another place where you can see deep learning in the world is if you are doing anything like real-time translation. So this is actually when you use Google Translate on your phone. You can actually hold it up to an image and it will real-time translate things for you. As you see in the top left-hand versus the top right-hand side, on the top left-hand side, we have English. On the top right-hand side, we have Portuguese. And what's kind of interesting is you see how it says like stop translation, because as it's computing this in real time, based on the sensitivity or maybe the possible output coming back, you may get different language that spits back at you. What's actually happening here is under the hood, a neural network is being used to read the image with OCR, optical character recognition, an area of research in computer vision. So what's happening is it's taking that image, translating it into text, then actually literally translating that text from your source language to your target language and then mapping it back onto the image. So, and that's another place that we may see deep learning in the world around us. Now, let's see if this one will work. Anyone kind of see where my mouse is? Right? Right. Click. Down. Click. Okay.
Meet Jennifer Lore Semi, a deep fake mashup of actor Steve Buscemi and actress Jennifer Lawrence. This deep fake video portrait uses Buscemi's face on Lawrence's body, along with her facial expressions.
I've never looked better.
Scarily realistic deep video portraits like this could take fake news to the next level.
Cool. So when we talk about deep fakes, and I imagine many of you heard this, it's like deep fakes, deep whatever. I don't know. It's like the deep apocalypse right now. But what this YouTube series called Digital Trends is focusing on is how it is that deepfake technology comes about. So what we're seeing, this kind of comedic mashup between actor Steve Buscemi and actress Jennifer Lawrence, well, to us and Buscemi jokes, I never have looked better, which may be true. this is just one example of ways that we're seeing deep learning actually being used in society around us to challenge our sense of what is true in the world around us, and perhaps even shifting our definition of what truth means. So the place that I got really interested in kind of seeing how deep learning has been entering our world has been looking at the fun place we call social media. Fun, I will use that loosely because fun can be subjective, but I started seeing things like this floating around. This is, I believe, May 2018, where what you see is a dialogue of people talking about scripts they had generated using deep learning. So on the left-hand side, what you see is Twitter user Keaton Patty proclaiming, "I forced a bot to watch 1,000 plus hours of the Saw movies, then made it to write its own script. Here's the first page." Wow, that is quite a project to undertake. But the idea here of now saying that we can take deep learning and apply it to this idea of like, what's it mean to actually to do something creatively? Because when we think of arts or we think of entertainment, we think of it as a creative process. On the right-hand side, what you then start to see are people actually pushing back and saying, well, actually, how true is this? When looking at this text, I've noticed that there's words like Trump and whale, words that this user alleges were not even present in any of the Saw script movies. I personally have not verified that because, well, one, I don't want to watch all the Saw movies, and two, I don't want to imagine a scene where Trump and a whale exist together. That's just going to give me bad nightmares. I don't want to go there. But all that to say that when people start talking about what's possible with deep learning and when we start applying it to what we think of as the creative processes or creative outlets, we start getting into this kind of subtler definition of what does it mean to be creative and what does it mean to actually model creativity in the world. Now, this is actually an interesting and very, very absurd short, and I won't be playing it, but I encourage you to go check out this Ars Technica piece. This is actually a project that was brought about by Strange Loop alumni Ross Goodwin in talking about how he and a group of people actually used AI to actually generate the entire script for this very absurd, surrealist 5-minute short. And it does include David Hasselhoff. I don't think the AI was like, you must have David Hasselhoff. I just think they were like, that seemed like a great idea. So, you know, all that to say that that deep learning is in many places in the world around us, be it from providing real-time streaming analytics for understanding human processes like traffic, to doing translation in demand, to actually us now using it to compute and create art. Deep learning has really been pushing the way that we think about the intersectionality of people and technology. So back to this point, why telenovelas? Because obviously in the title of this talk, it says Escuincla babosa, a Python deep learning telenovela. Well, why not would be my first answer. Why not telenovelas? But really, let's kind of go back to something that I love. So back to my utter love of things you can find or ways you can express your emotion when using social. One of my most favorite ones is involving this scene from a very, very famous telenovela called Maria la del Barrio. So this is a very, very interesting scene and perhaps one of the most even more absurd than perhaps the David Hasselhoff AI-inspired short. And this was like written by people, so you know that says something. So let me give you a little bit of a context of what this story is. So kind of the characters that we have on the left-hand side make up the heart of this story. But the basic premise is that our main character, or rather our main villain in this narrative, is the bottom left character, Soraya Montenegro. She is the main antagonist in this iconic 1990s Mexican telenovela. And let's just say that Soraya, as a person, she's not exactly the best. To put it into context, here's a little bit about her background. Soraya is having a party where Nandito, that's the boy that's in the top right, her ex's son sneaks into her stepdaughter, Alicia, which is the top left, sneaks into her room and tells her, I love you, te quiero. And as this moment of, you know, young, joyful love is being shared between two people, Nandito asks, can I kiss you, Alicia? And Soraya then walks in at just that moment. And oh, by the way, Soraya is deeply in love with her ex, which is the father of Nandito. She walks in and sees this imminent kiss, and her obvious answer is to scream, Escuincla, babosa, which very loosely, roughly translated means, you stupid, spoiled, entitled brat. So if anyone ever really gets under your skin, just like scream that at them. The next few minutes are a huge mess, and what we observe can at best be described as a very dramatic fight. Soraya basically fights everyone, including the nanny, which is featured in the middle, and then some random man who just shows up in a suit, and you're not explained like why at all he's there. So like everyone was getting in, it was like, you know, a little bit like the Jets or something, I don't know. But yeah, so when thinking about, you know, telenovelas and the absurdity that already exists in them, I'm like, okay, well, if we're able to generate kind of absurdity using deep learning, what can happen when we combine these two? And just to give you a little context about this scene, and again, help me with my mouse. Good, click. Higher. Click. Thank you.
No se te ocurriera poner los ojos en él. ¡Y los pusiste! ¡Escuincla, babosa! ¡Te atreviste! ¡Pero te va a pesar! ¡Te va a pesar!
So the full scene is like 6.5 minutes, where it starts in wanting to keep in the theme of a PG rated talk, because it gets real extra. And of course I love it. But that just kind of gives you a little bit of the context of like the over the top, the like extra. It's like, what is even happening? Why is Nandito now yours? I don't understand. But all this to say is, obviously when we see this, we know that it's highly absurd, but yet we love it. And if you don't, you will after this talk. So to help us think a little bit about what it means to generate a telenovela using deep learning, let's take a step back and think about what is a telenovela. So Jorge Gonzalez, who is a genetic epistemologist, whew, that's a mouthful, basically one that studies the development of knowledge, that's a cool job, at the National Autonomous University of Mexico, he describes telenovelas as a social phenomena of televised melodramas that are based on the construction of a relationship of fidelity with the audience. Or to put it another way, telenovelas are a series of stories that creates a relationship of fidelity, or that is intense loyalty with the audience. So to put it even more succinctly, it's not that we just like telenovelas, we want to watch them, we must watch them, we're compelled to watch telenovelas. Thinking about this from the global perspective of the popularity of them, these serial melodramas are beloved worldwide. Some stats on the Latin American telenovelas: we have Latin American telenovelas that are watched in more than 100 countries. Approximately $800 million a year is invested in creating telenovelas, with Mexico alone creating almost 3,000 hours of telenovelas each year at a total cost of approximately $250 million US dollars, which was more or less the cost of, say, the Hollywood blockbuster Titanic. So that means then we have about 2 billion people that are watching telenovelas today, or approximately like a third-ish of the global population. So yes, there is a real love for telenovelas. So the idea of this serialized melodrama that has this kind of faithful and strong relationship with its audience, let's think about how that relationship is built. So we're gonna have to think a little bit about the arc of a telenovela. These arcs are going to have to include a little bit of what we've talked about, which is that relationship with the audience, and it's also going to have to tell us a little bit about how it is we can maybe even believe some of these stories are possible. So if we take a step back and look at some of this, Dr. Diana Ross of the University of Connecticut, in a 2012 PBS NewsHour special talking about the impact and power of telenovelas, kind of summarized the cultural significance of telenovelas as something that, a situation where we have to have things that are cleaned up so the audience has satisfaction. They don't want to worry about Maria. Did she find love? Did she find her true mother or her true father? Apparently, it's always about finding someone who's like true in your life. But that idea that you don't want these open-hanging questions, that you have some kind of wrap-up at the end, that's actually something that has become known about telenovelas quite well. Back to Dr. Gonzalez from UNAM, he additionally proposes that the three social processes that make this relationship of fidelity between the viewer and telenovela possible is these three things. One, building symbolic commonalities between the social agents and culture. Two, creating a believable set of worlds. And three, enacting symbolic struggles that define basic human cultural elements in these worlds. So in the case of a telenovela, when we think about how there's all these struggles, these struggles, which again, that's back to point three that adds up to a successful telenovela, the points of these struggles is that they are used to prolong the inevitable conclusion, pulling at our heartstrings so that we continue to faithfully watch right up to the very end. This relationship is only possible, though, because we know that the audience expects a happy ending and that they know a happy ending is coming. So for example, my family, my father's family is from Mexico. One of the things that I remember in my life is the corridos, which are a very specific and distinct kind of music genre and are often these kind of power-like love ballads. And while they go through some kind of challenge, at the end there's always a happy kind of wrap-up. So for example, we've got a famous corrido here, La Fama de la Pareja by Los Tigres del Norte. Back to my mouse. Up. Right. Okay, let's see.
For mild to moderate eczema,
that's a commercial.
It's steroid-free. Do not use if you are allergic to Eucrisa or its ingredients.
That's silly.
Allergic reactions may occur at or near the application site.
We're just gonna remove this.
Application site pain. Ask your doctor about Eucrisa.
I'm so sorry. Again, it's the drama. Desde Jalisco salieron. I just wanted to toggle because that's a bit easier to stop the video. But some of the lyrics and I don't think there's an actual official music video. This was like a dedicated fan. But the reason I like this one is it did pair a little bit, particularly for those of you who may not speak Spanish, it paired a little bit of the scenery with what's happening in the song. So what we see are some lyrics on the left-hand side, but this story that we're given is the story of a couple, Rosa and Luis. They traffic something very dangerous, though we're never explicitly told what, between Jalisco to San Diego, and then when they are in San Diego, Luis says to his wife, "Oh yeah, we did something. I'm glad we survived." And she's like, "What did we do?" Some more things happen. And then at the tail end of the song, what we're left with is this narrative of why why they are the most famous couple is because when they crossed the border back to Jalisco with many millions of dollars, their businesses were prosperous. So So, like, even in, like, a 2-minute and 45-second song, we see this entire arc at play time and time again, and I am here for it. So the arc of a telenovela, what we see then is that we need to be able to tell a story that bars from the social world of the viewer, building a believable world where the series has these believable struggles. Granted, when we say believable struggles, some of these are maybe pushing it a little bit in telenovela land. I mean, the amount of times people can have amnesia, I don't know. But translating this back to kind of our theme that we would want to think of in how to construct a telenovela arc, we want to think of these three things. A fixed melodramatic plot, that is long lost mothers and daughters fighting, lots of finding all the love, maybe losing it again, I don't know. A fixed story arc with an actual end, and then a conclusion that ties up these loose ends with a generally happy element. For example, big wedding, or, you know, somehow becoming millionaires after doing something dangerous you didn't know you did. So all that to say, these three things really punctuate and are consistent in all of our telenovela arcs. Because unlike perhaps some telenovelas or soap operas, the cousin of telenovelas, when we think of in the United States, those things can go on for years and years and years. I think As the World Turns is like almost as old, if not older than me. But yeah, that's actually one of the things that when we think about how it is we want to construct our story and we're thinking about what it is to build that believable world, we need to actually understand what it means to emulate an arc. So then let's go ahead and take the next step into our process. So we've talked about what a telenovela is, we've identified the story arc, and we are now thinking through like a formula that we may start to use to help us build this telenovela. So let's actually look at the world of telenovelas and see what we have available. So with the telenovelas that we have available, there's three that are very, very famous. We have La Reina del Sur with Kate del Castillo, who is my muse and who I want to meet so bad. side note, she like went with Sean Penn to go like hang out with El Chapo, who's like this famous like drug like lord, and it's a whole thing. So her life is actually, I think, a telenovela. But so Kate del Castillo is in one of the most famous contemporary telenovelas, to the extent where she plays, her character is Teresa La Mexicana Mendoza. This was a $10 million project put on by Telemundo, the second most expensive that channel has ever put on. And actually, they just announced, because it's so popular with reruns, that they have a 2019 season. So that's one example. The second example, Yo Soy Betty La Fea. This one has been syndicated into so many markets, ranging from Belgium, India, to Turkey, that it itself is a prominent example. And actually, many say has elevated the status of telenovelas to a new way that we could talk about how successful they are as a trope, as a way to bring or develop stories. And then lastly, we have Juana la Virgen, which is a 2002 Venezuelan telenovela. But all these to say that these are three prominent examples, but here's the thing, they're in Spanish, right? Boom, luckily we have them in English. So finding kind of the quintessential ones, we can then move left to right. We've got Queen of the South, we've got Ugly Betty, and we've got Jane the Virgin. So to just give you context of each, the Queen of the South is about Teresa la Mexicana Mendoza, who flees Mexico to Spain because when her drug dealing boyfriend is killed by the gang he works for. She then rises to become the most powerful drug lord in all of Spain. And ultimately in the end, she's successful in getting her revenge on the people who took her beloved boyfriend. So it's a drama, lost love thriller. When we have the plot of Ugly Betty, it's a tragicomedy or comedy, depending on how you mash those up. As we probably know, this involved America Ferrera, and it involves the story of Betty, who is a personal assistant at the fictitious fashion empire Bradford Mead, which she specifically works at the Mode fashion magazine. Eventually, she wins everyone over with her charms and smarts. Yay. And then our last, Jane the Virgin, which is perhaps just the most random one of all, is where, as we've probably, maybe some of us have watched, and this has just recently culminated with its fifth season, we have Gina Rodriguez playing Jane, who is a religious young Latina who works as a waitress in a hotel in Miami. Ultimately, one day, her doctor somehow, like, accidentally, artificially inseminates her, and she's a virgin and becomes pregnant. Needless to say, at the end, she finds happiness, she has her child, she gets married. So boom, these are three perfect examples that fit our arcs. From from a drug lord that gets her vengeance to someone who accidentally becomes pregnant and then builds a happy family. So now that we've talked about what a telenovela is, we defined the arc of a telenovela, and we found some quintessential examples, how can we use deep learning to do text generation? So when we're thinking about text generation, or rather even machine learning as we take a step back, this is language that was introduced to us that first solidifies what is ML, explicitly that a computer can be said to learn without explicitly being programmed. Now, if you take that a step further, we get this language from Tom Mitchell, a professor of machine learning at Carnegie Mellon, who then says, okay, it's not even necessarily that it's not about being explicitly programmed, but when we have three things that we have to do in an ML program, it is we have to provide it some experience to perform some task, and then we can evaluate how well we're doing with a performance measurement. So in the landscape of machine learning, we obviously have a lot. We have tools, we have technology, we have types of problems that we can solve, and then we have areas of research. Deep learning is in the landscape of areas of research. So the evolution from AI to deep learning has continued to build upon the idea of what does it mean to achieve learning and by what mechanism do we do it. In machine learning, we have supervised learning, which, for example, we have some prior historic ground truth or experience that we then give to our algorithm to say, okay, this is what we want as an output on the other side. Then for unsupervised learning, what we have is actually we don't know what the structure is going to look like on the other side, so the algorithm is actually going to find that, it's going to actually find the clusters, or it's going to find the output, decide what that output should look like, and give us that on the other side. So with deep learning, what we instead are using now is a neural network to power its own learning. So in thinking about an example for deep learning, if we're doing a classification problem, consider a programmable flashlight that will turn on when it hears the audio cue, it's dark. Now, a deep learning implementation will actually not only just be able to say it can respond to something when it hears it's dark and turn on, but it also will be able to understand other phrases that indicate darkness or absence of light. For example, I can't see. This learning is powered by the brain, the activation function, that neural network. If you're trying to think about kind of how that works, think about how we might start providing meaning between words. So in our example, we were talking about a flashlight. In the graphic here, we kind of have this idea of concepts of mom and milk. As you notice with mom, they may be connected to such things as house care or parent. Maybe for milk, the color white. But this idea of how we start to derive kind of meaning and then associate relationships between things, that is actually what our deep learning models are actually able to do for us, is to actually start to evaluate and build meaning that we didn't intrinsically program into it. So the neuron itself is a simplified version of it. It looks like this. We've got our inputs. In this case, we will be talking about text. We have some weights. That is, the higher the number, the more significant that input is. And then the combination of those two are mutated with an activation function. And then on the other side, we get our outputs, which is the weighted sum of inputs. So too long didn't read. A neuron is a mathematical function. In training our neuron, it's basically just iteratively updating the weights associated with the feature input vector by using the nonlinear activation function, for example, a sigmoid function. The more that activation mutates the input vector, then we say it has a higher learning rate. Effectively, the training process is just approximating the underlying relationship to the data set until it finds the optimal set of weights to actually mirror that relationship. So back to that deep fake at the beginning, there was actually in February of this year a group called OpenAI that created what's called the GPT-2 algorithm, where they trained on a whole bunch of different data sets, and they said, actually, it's so scary because to put into the world and show you all how we do this, because humans have a hard time discerning between what is machine generated and what is not. If you want to go and take a look at this, talktotransformer.com has an implementation on this. That's a project by Adam Kings, who runs a blog that talks about this. So the idea of kind of like feeding in text and then getting more text generated as a result, that's kind of the way we can think about generating a telenovela. So back to text generation, sequence and processing includes such problems as text generation, video processing, et cetera. So with the two approaches that we have available, we can either do a character model or a word model. And then if we want to know something sounds telenovela-ish, boom, we're going to use the we're going to use the scripts from our model from our telenovelas that we found earlier. So needless to say, there's a few different types of architecture patterns you can choose from. What has been proven to work well with text generation is an RNN, specifically a long short-term memory model, and that is what we'll be using. The advantage there is you can propagate information forward and backward, so as it's learning insights, it's actually going to feed it back into itself so that it is able to advance its own learning in a better way. Thinking a little bit about how that architecture looks, you might get something like this, where you have additional layers feeding that and moving that information back and forward. So I won't go deep into this because I know we're a little short on time, but what I did do in this talk is actually look at three different implementations you can use for creating an RNN in Python, specifically looking at these three, Keras, TensorFlow, and PyTorch. Python has been really well received in the scientific computing space. If you don't believe me, ask Jake Vandenplas. He has a great keynote from PyCon 2017 called The Unexpected Success of Python in Science. But needless to say, when you're choosing kind of what tools to use, these are great questions to think about. What technical expertise do you need? What are your requirements? And how easy is the framework to start working with? So for me, I am a beginner. I want to do a toy project, and I want to do something that has a good community that I can find demos and use cases with. And I only have less than 100 megabytes of data since I'm only working with three sets of telenovelas and their scripts. And then lastly, I want something that has good debugging capability. So of these three, what's really cool, TensorFlow 2.0 as of this year is now officially using Keras as its high-level API, which is pretty awesome because Keras is very nice and intuitive to use for those that are beginners. And in fact, it also then now uses eager execution, which is pretty good. In addition, it also adds in some other things like dataset API. So TensorFlow 2.0 is what I would recommend looking at. For those of you who are like, what is static execution versus eager or dynamic execution? Eager execution basically means it's going to run your code sequentially, so it makes it easier to debug, whereas static execution is actually going to create the structure in advance for your neural network. And then as it runs, because the compiler can basically say, oh, I see that I can optimize the structure by doing this thing here or this thing there. But for debugging and for getting started, using eager execution is a bit easier. So in doing an RNN in Python, what you see is you basically would transfer your words into, you want to transfer your words into a vector. You want to do this hot encoding, which essentially says that, essentially we want to generate this hot encoding, and I will have an example in the next slide. But what we're doing is we're tokenizing our words into a one hot vector. For character levels, we tokenize each letter rather than each word. Then when we have those encodings generated, that becomes the input. That's what you feed into your model. And then we train for N epochs. So an example for doing this one hot vector encoding is an example here where you take a word, you have a corpus with so many words, you say that given the unique words, that's the length of your corpus, and then you can translate and say, well, how many times does the character like B appear in that corpus? And then for each of those nine individual instances in your corpus, you can actually do a counting. So this has some sample code that you can kind of look at, but again, just to kind of point out some of the simplicity here, you see that you can build a model, then from building the model, you're actually able to go ahead and use Keras to apply the LSTM. And then once you've built it, you can go ahead and compile that model. And what's really nice here is then you can go ahead and train that model quite easily. Notice that you've got the epoch value that you can specify. And again, that's how many times you want to run it through, because at each time as you simulate, you want to be reducing your loss. That is the amount of information you gain each time you're training. So when you run that, you're actually able to then output the weight of those, you're able to export the weights associated, and you're able to find what is the most optimal like loss value that you want to get to. And when you find that, you're then able to say, okay, let's go ahead and build our model. And when we build our model, we're actually then able to drop in the optimal weight file that we found from running through so many epochs. So I'm going to get to now just this last bit, which is generating a telenovela script with an RNN. What's possible? So in thinking through different ways we can do this, you can see on this side that there's kind of a few different ways that you get some text. I started trying to optimize for 100 character output. And what you see when you get like kind of these three different approaches at the top, I know the language is quite special, but is it a milagro means miracle? Is it a miracle? And notice that's with Jane the Virgin. She miraculously got pregnant. On the second one, which is with Ugly Betty, the graphics department, remember she works in like a fashion industry. And then the third one, Queen of the South, do not threaten me. I'm like, I want more of that. But all that to say, when you start melting these all then together, you start getting a different kind of narrative and prose that results on the other side. I'm proof that surprise happened. Okay, even if you do not believe me, why would you? I am a woman after all. Boom. So so where I'm at now these days is now thinking about how it is we can create a model for each of our characters and then how those characters then can be mapped back to other telenovelas. So for example, if we want an LSTM for Soraya, one for Namito, one for the random dude who walks in with the soup, we can go ahead and start mixing all these together. So making an LSTM model per character in your script, what we need to do is we need to think about getting similar sources of inspiration, weaving these models together, and then even maybe thinking about what plot type we want to generate. So yes, text generation is hard for doing better. As you can see, varying data quality is a hard one. What these two demonstrate is that they're special characters, that sometimes you get the character's name. I do so love that there is a Latin lover as a narrator in Jane the Virgin. Like, can I just like have a narrator in my life? But all this to say, this data set did not exist. I actually have been going into the world and doing this myself and maybe asking my cousins to help me with this. I'm currently working right now on Rosalinda, Dos Mujeres, Un Camino, and I'm working on some more. And if you want to add any of your telenovela scripts, because this is a thing you want to do, please do on GitHub. I've got a link for that. Again, deep learning is only as smart as you make it. If you would like some continued learning, you can check here. And that is the end of my talk, and I appreciate you all so much. And thank you for being so helpful.